All right, so I'm beginning a series tonight. We're starting one that has to do with leadership attributes. Leadership attributes. Now, this is going to be more geared towards just in general. The focus is going to be leadership within, you know, church and spiritual things. However, the principles that we're covering are all very applicable to any leadership. And, you know, ladies, I don't want you thinking that these sermons aren't going to be for you. Even though you might not be attaining a leadership position of like a pastor or something in a church, you still have leadership that you have to exert at home with your children, as well as raising children. If you're raising sons, you want them to grow up to be good leaders too. There's a lot of good qualities here that it's going to be beneficial for everybody to learn. But specifically, we're going to be going over a lot of different things, and we're going to be focusing on just one attribute or one quality every week. And we'll be doing this for a few weeks. But when we started off here in 2 Timothy, there's a lot of information. So the books of 1 and 2 Timothy, as well as Titus, from the epistles of Paul, he's writing these letters to these men, these elders, these pastors of churches, these young men that have been taught and trained by the Apostle Paul, and he's specifically giving them instruction. This is where you're going to find in 1 Timothy chapter 3, the qualifications for a bishop. These you're going to find, you know, how we ought to behave ourselves in the house of God. You're going to find a lot of things when it just comes to their jobs, their functions, what they need to be doing specifically. And we're going to be digging into a lot of these scriptures as well as a bunch of others. But we start off here in verse number 1. The Bible reads, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." So what he's telling Timothy to do is take everything you've learned. You've learned a lot from me. Take the doctrine, take the teachings, take this stuff and teach it. He says, commit it unto faithful men. So the subject I'm covering tonight as far as leadership attributes is, I think, probably one of the most important attributes is that of faithfulness, being faithful. Faithful also means dependable, reliable, trustworthy, someone you can count on. This is the type of person that you want to have as a leader. I mean, that only makes sense. If you're going to follow anybody, you want to follow someone who doesn't have their act together. You want to follow somebody who's not faithful in what they do. You're going to end up going nowhere. There's going to be no confidence in a leader like that. Now, it says here is also who shall be able to teach others also. So the goal is to teach other people and to continue teaching and to make more leaders and to make more people who are faithful, they're reliable, they're dependable. Turn to Matthew chapter 24. We'll see a few examples of faithful men receiving leadership positions. Now, I want to point this out. These are the types of attributes or characteristics that you ought to be striving to have just because they're good anyways. What I mean by that is, you know, when a person might be chosen to fill a leadership role, this isn't the type of thing where you have tryouts and have a bunch of people with their name ahead. You're going to be selecting, whoever's going to be selecting people, they're going to be selecting it based on people who are already exhibiting these behaviors, who are already demonstrating that they're faithful. It's not like I'm going to have my tryouts now and then I'm going to prove to you that I'm faithful because here's my checklist and I'm going to go through this and you're going to watch me do these things and in a specific time or you know, come into my office now and explain to me why you're faithful. That's not how it works. These are attributes, these are characteristics that you need to have. If you have a desire, the Bible says, you know, if you desire the bishop of an office, you desire the office of a bishop, you desire a good work. It's a good thing to want to do that. But if you do desire that, you need to make sure that these qualities or characteristics are representative of you in general, just all the time. Because when it's just, I mean, think about just a worldly example, just being at work. The person who gets positions and gets promoted, at least in well-run companies, are going to be the ones who have already shown that they're a hard worker. You get five people in some minimum wage job, right? And you've got a manager watching their workers. They have to manage their employees. And four of them do only what they're told. They might show up on time or whatever. They might get their work done. But if they have to do anything else, it's, well, that's not my job. That, you don't pay me to do that, you know, and just kind of have this attitude of just not willing to do anything else but just the bare minimum. But then you have one guy who's doing his work. He's showing up on time. If you need someone to cover a shift, he's the first one to say, yep, I'll take that shift. You need someone to do any extra work, he's going out of his way. He doesn't even have to be told. He's taking initiative to do new stuff. You know who's going to get promoted? That's the guy that's going to get promoted every single time. Even without him actively pursuing a promotion. Just because that's how they are. That is how they're demonstrating their work. That is, you know, they're doing that job. That is what management and leaders are looking for in other leaders. The Apostle Paul is telling Timothy here that he needs to find the faithful men in order to commit this teaching to. Find the dependable ones. Find the reliable ones. You should already know who's reliable. Who can you depend on when you have your church services, when you've got work that needs to be done? Who do you rely on? You know, you might have a bunch of people that can give you excuse after excuse why they can't do something, but then you're going to have people who are reliable, dependable, you can trust that they will be there. That's who you want to commit this, you know, all these teachings to, that they can go and teach others also, that you know that it's going to continue on. Matthew 24, we're going to see this play out in just some examples in Scripture. Look at verse number 42. Matthew 24, verse 42. The Bible says, watch therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. But know this, that if the good men of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched, and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household to give them meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. This is an example of a ruler who sets a servant to do a specific job, to do a task, and he's saying, you don't know when I'm going to come back, right? And he's just saying, be ready. So the person who's given a job to do, who's given a task, you shouldn't just be doing the task because there's someone watching over you, right? The boss should be able to leave, go out of town, entrust you to do business, but then at any moment he comes back, he's going to find you working. He's going to find you busy. He's going to find you doing faithfully what he expected you to do, what he told you to do. That's what the Bible's saying here, you know, who is that faithful and wise servant? And he says, blessed is that servant. When the Lord does come back, he finds him doing exactly what he's supposed to be doing. Now, obviously, this applies to, you know, us being ready for the return of Jesus Christ, things like that. But it's just a very simple concept. And then he says in verse 47, verily I say unto you, then he shall make him ruler over all his goods. There comes the promotion. You got someone, I got a job for you. He's being faithful, he's reliable, he's dependable. The Lord comes back, he finds him doing all this stuff. Great. Well done. Now I'm going to give you even more stuff. Now I'm going to give you more authority, more goods, and you know, elevate them to a status of being a ruler also. Turn to Matthew 25, just one page over. We see another very similar example, Matthew 25, verse number 19. The Bible says, after a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliveredst unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. He's saying, I gave you just a few things to do, but you did it. You're reliable, you're dependable, you're faithful. You did exactly what I said to do. Now, as a result, you're going to be blessed. Be thou ruler over many things. And then we see the other people come. You know, the one received two, and he gains two. And then the one who received one, in verse 24, it says, then he which had received the one talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid, and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast, that is thine. His Lord answered and said unto him, thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gather where I have not strawed. Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him, and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. Now again, I'm not going to go into all the spiritual applications of these parables. It's but just real basic on the surface. There's some great truths that's being taught here, that when you have a faithful servant, when you have someone who's reliable, when you have someone doing their job, day in, day out, you give them a task, they get it done. You don't have to worry about, is it going to get done? They're being fruitful. They're going and saying, hey, look, this is what you gave me, and I gained you this. Then they're going to be blessed. And then the one he's saying here that didn't do what they're supposed to do, they're not being faithful, they're losing the only, you know, the one thing they even had. Just taken away from them. So, yep, take that away from him, give it to that guy who did the most work, who was the most faithful. Give him even more. Bless him even more. Turn to Luke chapter 16. Why is it so important to be found faithful in order to lead? Leadership is not just a job title. I've worked in different places where, you know, some people put more emphasis on their title than they do on their actual job. And some people think that just because they have a certain title that gives them some special powers or whatever. And you have typically the really bad leadership or management are just relying on their title than they are on their leadership skills. I worked for a place where ultimately I ended up becoming a leader, not because I never had the title, never one time. But after enough time, it was just long enough. Just if I told anybody to do something, they would do it, other than like the boss. Because leadership has really nothing to do with the title as much as it has to do with how effective you are at being a leader and getting people to follow you. And one way you're going to do that is by being faithful and dependable. Being someone who's trustworthy and demonstrates that you are willing to do the work, and not just willing, but you do the work. You are an example of doing the work. So why is it so important to be found faithful? Well, think about this. What if I didn't show up to every church service as the pastor, right? I'm the leader within our group here, within the church. What if I just, well, sometimes I come, sometimes I don't, right? You show up to church and you're just like, wow, I wonder if Pastor Berzins going to be here today. And it's like, well, what are you going to do then? Well, I got caught up. I had to work. I had to do something else. I mean, that's not very faithful. It wouldn't be very dependable if that's what's going on. You ought to be able to show up and be like, I know Pastor Berzins is going to be there because he's there every single time. Every single service, he's there. It doesn't matter what's going on. He will be there. And I mean, think about this. What if I showed up every time, but I was just unprepared? I'm just like, okay, well, we'll sing some songs, but sorry, guys, I don't have a sermon for you today. I just wasn't able to get that done. So we'll read a passage here, and then we'll just be dismissed. Right? No one's going to take you seriously, right? How can you look to someone to lead and to guide if you can't be faithful in even that which is least yourself? I mean, it should go without saying that the pastor of a church ought to be there for all of your church services, or at the very least, have someone then who is also faithful, reliable, and in line to step up and take the place, and have that already scheduled in advance that, hey, this person is going to preach on this night or whatever, and that you are taking care of all of your obligations that need to be done. That is what a good leader is going to do. And no one will respect you or take you seriously if you don't have that faithfulness. So just keep that in mind, because this is something that you need to have. You need to be able to demonstrate. If you want someone to appoint you to a job of being a leader and to take on more responsibility, you need to be faithful in that which is least, which is what Luke 16 says. Look at verse number 10. Luke 16, verse 10, it says, "He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much." Why? Because it's a character trait. If you're willing to be reliable and dependable on that which is least, on things that seemingly might not even matter that much, if you're not cutting the corners and just skipping every once in a while on the things that are the least, then you know then the things that matter, they're going to be the person that you want to have over that, because they'll be reliable and dependable on the more important things. The problem is when you get the people who just, whatever, not a big deal. And you see it all the time. I see it all the time out in the workforce. People who just, I don't want to clean that toilet or do this or do some job I just don't want to do. I just can't rely on that person. Some problem comes up and you've got one guy who maybe they'll do it, maybe they won't. Just depends on what you're asking them to do, versus another one who just says, "I don't care. I'm here to work. I'll do it." That's the faithful attitude you need to have. And when you have that faithful attitude, I don't care if you're getting underpaid. I don't care if it seems like you're going nowhere. If you have that attitude, you will go somewhere. Someone will notice it, and you will get promoted, and you will get elevated. And you keep that humble attitude, but a faithful attitude. God sees what you do, and God will make sure that you receive whatever it is that's right and just. Let's keep reading here. Luke 16, verse 10. "He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if ye have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own?" And again, this, don't slack from being faithful because you think that whatever you're doing isn't very important anyways. It's a wrong attitude to have. It's not an attitude that a good leader is going to have. If someone gives you a job to do, then you should be faithful in getting that job done regardless of how small you think it is. The Bible says that, all things that we do should be done heartily as unto the Lord and not unto men. And we shouldn't be doing work as men pleasers, where you only are doing hard work when someone's watching you, and then when they're gone, you're just screwing around and not getting anything done. Because if you want to be a leader, you can't have that type of an attitude. You're not going to be a successful leader at all. It's not going to work out for you. You might get by at your job and not get fired, but you're not going to be the person that people are looking to promote and to be in charge and run things and be a leader. And in that verse 12 where he says, if you can't be faithful in that which is another man's, if you can't even be responsible with what someone else gives you, then how are you going to be responsible with your own stuff? Turn to Psalm 12. Actually, you know what? Don't turn to Psalm 12. Turn to Proverbs. Proverbs 10. I'll read for you from Psalm 12 because I think we live in a time now that's getting harder and harder to find the faithful men. Find people who have that ethic. Find people who are trustworthy and dependable and aren't just willing to drop their obligations because something fun pops up. And that's what it means to be faithful. What it means is if you have an obligation to do something, but someone, this great concert comes up or this other opportunity for me to go have fun or get this vacation or whatever, the faithful person says, you know what, I've got responsibilities I have to take care of and I need to make sure these are met before I could go and do anything else for myself. I have already been obligated to do something for someone else. That needs to be done. Psalm 12:1 says, "Help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth, for the faithful fail from among the children of men. They speak vanity, everyone with his neighbor, with flattering lips and with a double heart do they speak." And this younger generation, I think, is getting accustomed to not having to work very hard for things. There's just too many things being given to them on a silver platter. Especially, you think about the minimum wage laws and stuff that are, I don't know what they're like out here, but I know in Arizona they're going up to, I think they're going up to like $15 an hour. Like, and they might be there right now, but it was just like to flip burgers or something. It's like, are you kidding me? Well, everyone needs to have a living wage, and this whole concept of just, well, everyone just needs, you can't pay someone less, you just have to pay someone this. No, you don't. No, you pay someone for what they do. Not because they have a position, not just because they have a title. Not because you're employing, I mean, you employ someone to do the most mindless work. You don't have to pay that person the wage of someone else who actually needs to think and is reliable and dependable and everything else. It's not equal. It shouldn't be equal. But we have a problem with people thinking that they're entitled to it. The faithful fail from among the children of men. It's not a very faithful generation that we have today. Being faithful, Proverbs 10, look at verse number 26, the Bible says, as vinegar to the teeth and as smoke to the eyes, so is the sluggard to them that send him. You got a task to do, and you send someone who's a sluggard, someone who's not reliable, someone who's lazy. And it's like smoke to the eyes. Man, don't you hate that when you sit around a campfire and the smoke just seems to be blowing your way all the time and you just got the smoke going in your eyes and you can't even enjoy being by the fire? The Bible said that's the way it's like when you send some lazy person to do a task for you. It's just that irritating because they just don't get the job done right or at all because you're sending someone who's lazy, someone who has no character, someone who's never going to be a leader because they're not taking their job seriously and they cannot be relied upon. Proverbs, turn if you would to, turn to Genesis 18. Proverbs 25:13 says, as the cold of snow in the time of harvest, so is a faithful messenger to them that send him, for he refresheth the soul of his masters. So, and that's obvious, a great, it's a refreshment. People, when you can rely on somebody, and that's the key. When you can rely on someone to get the job done, it's only going to be a matter of time before you want that person elevated to be able to do even more work. And you could have even less involvement with them and let them go and run and do their work. That's what's happening with these churches too, especially in these early churches. The Apostle Paul is teaching and training specific people, and he taught and he trained Timothy and Titus, and then he's telling them, okay, now you need to take what I've taught you, and you need to instruct other faithful people so then they could in turn also find other faithful people and instruct them. And these churches that were being established that were lacking, they needed pastors, they needed bishops. He's instructing Timothy and Titus to go ordain elders of these people. But this is the type of person that you need to have in charge. And he gives the attributes. And like I said, as the weeks progress, we'll be going through different qualities, different attributes that are going to be important in leadership. But I think the number one quality is being faithful. If you cannot be depended upon to do a job, then you will never be promoted to a position of leadership. You have to make sure you're there. And being dependable, it's not just showing up, but how about showing up on time? I'm planning soon on having meetings with some of the men in the church that want to do more. And I'll just throw this out there right now. If anybody's interested in stepping up and doing more things and being more involved in church, I'm going to be looking for people that can, one, be relied upon, that are faithful, that have demonstrated themselves to be faithful. Not just in attendance, but getting here early or getting here on time and making sure that you're willing to help and doing stuff that you've already demonstrated that you want to do these things. Those are going to be the people that I'm looking for to help out in these areas and to continue to progress, gaining more and more responsibilities. And this is the way that the Bible teaches that is that also needs to be looked for. This is the way that the Apostle Paul instructed Timothy and Titus. You're in Genesis 18. Stay there for a minute. I'm going to read from Hebrews chapter 3, verse number 1. The Bible reads, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. Of course, Jesus Christ is our perfect example for everything. But the Bible says, hey, he was faithful. Everything that God the Father said for the Son to do on this earth, he did every single thing that was required of him, everything. He went, he did it, and he did it happily. He did everything that he was supposed to do. He was completely faithful. And it actually compares Moses to Jesus Christ as Moses was. And we have a few people, I was trying to think of who are some of the best leaders in the Bible. And some of the people I came up with, the first ones that popped to my head as far as good leaders in the Bible, people who were, you know, a lot of people were behind and would follow: Abraham, Moses, Joshua, the Apostle Paul. Right now, I mean, King David was another one that a lot of people just got behind and was a good leader. You're in Genesis 18. I'm going to show you why these people were good leaders. They had the skill of being, not the skill, but the attribute of being faithful. When it comes to Abraham in Genesis 18, God knew what Abraham was going to do because he knew his character. He knew what type of person Abraham was to be that leader. And it's not just because God is God, he knows everything. But Abraham demonstrated his faithfulness. Look at Genesis 18, verse number 19. The Bible says, "For I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him." I'm not going to get into all the details, but we see when Lot was taken captive. Do you remember the battle, the four kings and the five kings with Sodom? And Sodom was defeated, and Lot and his family and all those people were taken captive by the other kings, that Abraham took his servants and the men, his hired servants and the men of his household, he gathered them all together and went up to fight in order to free Lot and to get him back. Well, that is a good demonstration of leadership, because he was even able to convince everybody that worked for him, everybody that was underneath him, hey, let's all go up and do this. And he was way outnumbered. Way outnumbered. I mean, he was going up against kings of nations, and it was just Abraham and his household that was going up to, like, SEAL Team 6 going in with Abraham's hired servants to go in and rescue Lot. And he was successful, and he did it. And you know what? His servants willingly just went, and they followed him like, okay, let's go, let's get him. Why? Because he was a good leader. Because he was teaching and training his household. As God said, he says, I know him. I know Abraham. I know he's reliable. I know that I could trust him to command his children and his household after him to do what's right, to follow the Lord, and to be good people. Abraham had that characteristic. He has that quality. He was a good leader. Joshua chapter 11, we already went through this in our series in Joshua, but we saw with Moses and Joshua, how many times did I mention, did it come up in our reading? As Joshua 11, 15 says, as the Lord commanded Moses his servants, so did Moses command Joshua, and so did Joshua. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord commanded Moses. If you've been coming on Wednesday night, you'll be noticing that phrase has come up multiple times in multiple passages. Just, yep. Everything that the Lord said to do, Joshua did it. Everything that the Lord said to do, Moses did it. They left nothing undone. All that they were supposed to do was done. That is a faithful servant. That is someone that God was able to rely on to get these jobs done. They saw it all the way through. They did the work. They weren't perfect, which is another point, by the way, when we're discussing these attributes and qualities. No one is expecting perfection. No one is expecting you to be just you've never had a fault, everything is perfect. You know, that's not the standard. But there's a difference between perfection and someone who can be relied upon, and then people who just, they're in and out and you never know what's going on. Turn to 2 Kings chapter 2. It's the last place I'll have you turn. 2 Kings chapter 2. So we saw the biblical example of Abraham. We saw Moses and Joshua. And then in Acts chapter 20, the Bible says in verse 26, wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. That's the Apostle Paul speaking. Another great leader. He's saying, I have preached the whole counsel of God to you. I haven't left anything uncovered. I did it all. I left nothing undone and preached that to you. That's the reason why the Apostle Paul was such a great leader. He was reliable and dependable to do what God told him to do. We're going to see in 2 Kings chapter 2 now the blessing of being faithful all the way to the end and having the characteristics of being dependable, being reliable, being faithful. 2 Kings chapter 2, we're going to see the story of Elisha and Elijah. Look at verse number 1. The Bible reads, and it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Bethel. And Elisha said unto him, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel. And the sons of the prophets that were at Bethel came forth to Elisha and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And he said, yea, I know it. Hold ye your peace. And Elijah said unto him, Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho. And he said, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they came to Jericho. And the sons of the prophets that were at Jericho came to Elisha and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And he answered, yea, I know it. Hold ye your peace. And Elijah said unto him, tarry, I pray thee, here, for the Lord hath sent me to Jordan. And he said, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And they too went on. Now, what we see happening here is opportunity after opportunity for Elisha to stop journeying with Elijah, to just back off, to not be, because Elisha is Elijah's minister. He's his servant. He's his protege. He's the one learning from him. Elijah is the one that's the leader. He's the one going around and doing this work. And Elisha's there to help him, to minister to him and everything else. And Elisha's saying, you know what? Wherever you go, I'm going with you. I am here with you. I'm going to be faithful and dependable for you all the way to the end. And he's hearing from everyone else. The sons of the prophets say, hey, don't you know that? I mean, God's going to take him. You're not going to have Elijah anymore. He's like, look, I know it. Shut up. Be quiet. Hold your peace. Don't worry about it. And even Elijah is saying, all right, go ahead. You can just stay here. I'm going to go on by myself. And Elisha says, no. I'm going to be with you all the way to the end. And that's what a faithful person does. They stick with you all the way to the end. Ruth was another good example of someone who stuck with it to the end. When her husband died and her father-in-law died and she's just left there with her mother-in-law and that family, and her mother-in-law is saying, okay, you ladies can go back to your home where you grew up here and everything else. I'm going back to Israel. And she's like, no, I'm going to stay with you. I'm going to make sure, we're together. I became part of your family. I'm going to be here for you and help you and cling to you and cleave to you and to your family and to your God. And that was another great example. And both of these examples we're going to see here with Elisha as well as with Ruth, they were greatly blessed for taking that stand. When there didn't seem to be anything that they were going to gain, they weren't doing it for the purpose of gain or any type of fame or anything like that. They were doing it because it's the right thing to do. Because I'm going to be dependable, I'm going to be faithful, I'm going to be reliable, I'm going to be with you all every step of the way. And they end up receiving a great blessing. This church is going to go through hard times. I'll tell you that right now. Just be ready. I don't know when it's going to happen, but it's going to happen. There's going to be times where we're going to have the world against us. We're going to have media against us. We're going to have people potentially picketing. We'll probably be up on the news. I don't know exactly what's going to happen, but there's going to be something that's going to put stress and pressure on people here to leave, to go away, to stop working, to get out of the fight, to get out of this church, to be embarrassed or ashamed. There's going to be something that comes up. Inevitably, it will happen. But the choice is going to be up to you whether or not you're going to show yourself to be faithful or not. Are you going to allow yourself to succumb to outside pressures and influences of, you know, some unsaved family members or whoever that's going to cast their judgment on you because, oh, you're a part of that. Oh, don't you? You're part of that hate group? I can't believe you would go to a church that talks about homosexuals that way. Whatever the case may be, I mean, that's probably what it's going to be over. Especially knowing this wicked area and the amount of pride that goes on here. But whatever the case may be, the faithful person is not going to back down. They're going to be with there and stand with the people of God no matter what. They're going to be moving forward, just like Elisha did here with Elijah. He's saying, nope, I'm with you, I'm with you, I'm with you. And then finally, as a result of him being faithful to the end, look at what happens here. It says in verse 7, and 50 men of the sons of the prophets went and stood to view afar off, and they too stood by Jordan. And Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. And it came to pass when they were gone over that Elijah said unto Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. And he said, thou hast asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I am taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. And it came to pass, as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it, and he cried, my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And he saw him no more, and he took hold of his own clothes and rent him in two pieces. And of course we know that Elisha goes on and literally has a double portion of the spirit of Elijah on him to do double the miracles and double the works that Elijah did. And Elijah was a great man of God. But because he demonstrated his faithfulness, because one, he was a good minister, he was a good servant, but he stayed faithful. Even when he knew bad times were coming or whatever, Elijah's gonna be taken from me, so it doesn't matter. He's not gone yet. I'm still going to remain faithful. I'm going to be true to Elijah until the end. And he gets a great blessing as a result. Ruth was blessed when she married Obed. That's not right. Boaz. Thanks. I'm like, that's not right. She married Boaz. Obed was the son. But she was blessed. She went from having nothing then to marrying a man that was well provided for. And not only that, I mean, that's a small blessing compared to now being mentioned and referenced in the line of Jesus Christ, in that kingly line. Having David and then continuing all the way down to Jesus Christ. And she's mentioned in the New Testament in the lines of the genealogy. What a great honor. What a great blessing. None of that would have happened if she would have just been like, okay, I'm going home. You see, not everyone's going to be a leader. Not everyone's going to have the faithful quality. And there could still be a good person. Ruth could have still been a good person. And she still could have served the Lord. She still could have done other things. Right? Elisha, same way. He was a great guy. But demonstrating that faithfulness and just being reliable and dependable, that's what's going to get you that blessing. And that's what people are looking for to get a leadership position. Like I said, whether it be within the church or whether it be outside of the church, no matter what you're doing, if you want to have a better position, just keep working faithfully and not worried about who's all watching. You just do it. It'll be made known eventually anyways. And you know what? Sometimes that's even better. When you're just working and working and working and no one even knows about it, and you're working and working and working, you're doing, you're being faithful, you are just been on it for a long period of time, and all of a sudden a boss or someone's like, oh, how long have you been doing this for? forever or for a year or for 2 years or what, you know, like I've just been doing it. That's going to speak volumes, because you're not advertising and broadcasting everything you do. You're just being faithful and reliable and getting the job done. That will come back and turn out to be a blessing for you. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for the principles that we could learn from your word. Dear Lord, I pray that you would please help all of us here to be able to be, even if people are not pursuing leadership roles, dear Lord, it's just a great quality to have, to be faithful, to be dependable, to be reliable. Lord, help us all to be able to be relied upon by others within the church, that we could be relied upon for help when people need it, for counsel, for anything, dear Lord. I pray that you would please help us to be there for one another and to remain faithful. And most importantly, dear God, that we would remain faithful to you and not let anything come between our service to you. And Lord, just help us to be strong and faithful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.